Hi, everyone, and welcome to the NLL's Pride Month discussion. I'm really excited to be here with three esteemed panelists who all have super interesting and relevant stories to share. We'll keep this conversational, and hopefully it'll be an opportunity for all of you listening, as well as for me, to learn a little about the lacrosse intersection with the LGBTQIA community. So thank you everyone for being here, and thank you to all of our fans for your support as we make lacrosse for everyone. So we'll start by turning it over to each of our panelists to give a brief intro on their background and bios. So I'm gonna start with you, Kyle.
Kyle Kennery, I've been refereeing in the National Lacrosse League for the past 6 years. I'm glad there's no test on math skills today to try and figure out which year I actually started. I've been open pansexual male for the past, only 6 months, maybe a year now. And, but also kind of knew I was queer from very early days. Grew up in Georgetown, Ontario, playing lacrosse and hockey. Played junior lacrosse as a goalie and U19, both goalie and long pole. And got started with refereeing both hockey and lacrosse at age 14. Just was a great way to make some cash in the early days, and better than working at Tim Hortons like the rest of my buddies. And then just, you know, grew this passion for it. And so as my playing career came to a close, you know, by choice, not by choice, who's to say, but it was an opportunity to keep staying competitive, stay involved. So it's been an amazing journey, and being part of the National Lacrosse League has been an absolute thrill.
Awesome. Thanks for that. Michelle, we'll turn it over to you.
Thanks for having me today. And Kyle and Andrew, I'm so excited to get to know you guys more. I am Michelle Tumolo. I currently am the head coach at Wagner College over in Staten Island. Played at Syracuse, graduated in 2013. I'm from Mullicahill, New Jersey, which is in Southern Jersey. And I currently play for Team USA. I'm really grateful for those opportunities. I've played on the team for about like 11 years now, I think. And I've been out since I was in high school. It was something that I felt as soon as I started high school, started having feelings, and we'll get into it a little bit more later. But, and then I fully came out about, you know, that senior year, and I've been really lucky to have been living my true self and being authentic, but also having an amazing support system behind me. But yeah, so I've been really excited and really thankful to be a part of the lacrosse community. And I've had a great experience with being out and everything like that, but excited to kind of talk further about that and learn about both their stories. So yeah, that's me.
Thanks, Michelle. You're up, Andrew.
Well, thank you for having me, and yeah, very excited to learn more about Kyle and Michelle. And so I am originally from Boston, Massachusetts, and grew up playing ice hockey, and then I picked up lacrosse in middle school, which quickly became my sport, and was lucky enough to get recruited to play college lacrosse at Dartmouth in New Hampshire, and that was awesome. I played goalie there and had a really good time, was able to help my team go to the NCAA tournament, which is the only time in the history of Dartmouth men's lacrosse that we did that, against Michelle's Syracuse. And after that season, which was my sophomore year, I ended up coming out to my team, and after some bumps, it went actually very well. And I was able to play the last 2 years of college lacrosse as an openly gay person, and then get drafted actually to play in the, what was called Major League Lacrosse, I guess is now merged with the PLL, and did that for a couple summers while I was also had studied biology in college and went on to work in a cancer research lab in Boston while I was playing professional lacrosse on the weekend, and ended up going to graduate school, moved to sunny California. You can see the shine on my face from the hot, warm weather over here. And so I got a PhD in molecular biology, and I have continued as a scientist. So I'm a professor of molecular cell and developmental biology at UCLA. And that means I teach undergraduate students. And then I also do research. I have a research lab. We study prostate cancer. So I train and mentor PhD students and try to make advances in that area. But it's a little bit outside of the lacrosse world, but I've tried to stay engaged as much as I can. And I've been involved with the You Can Play project, as well as some other things like the Courage Game. So yeah, very excited to be here.
That's great. Well, thank you all for sharing your backgrounds. And I realized I failed to introduce myself. I'm the Deputy Commissioner of the National Lacrosse League and super passionate about inclusion and culture and really excited to dive into those issues with you. I think I'll start with you, Andrew. You came out at a time that was really less of a thing, right? Like today, there's some precedent and stories that have been shared and people to lean on who have gone through that process as adults. Obviously, you came out in college. I'm curious, you know, how you reached that decision and what that was like for you and for how long you struggled with that, if at all.
So when I, certainly growing up, there were no openly gay men in pro sports or really even in team sports in the NCAA and in college. So when I made the decision to come out, it was not really based on seeing someone having done that and be successful. It was more based on, it was the time in my life where I had just fallen in love and I didn't want to hide the relationship that I had. I was happy. And I'd also had a really great season. So the season when I came out, I had been named All Ivy League and All American and team MVP. And it felt like I had all this confidence. And if I was ever going to do it, that was going to be the moment. So I came out at a time when, yeah, there weren't really a lot of role models. And I didn't do it for someone else. I did it just because I didn't want to hide who I was from my teammates. You know, in college, you spend all your time with your teammates and they're your family. And I didn't want to hide who I was from, you know, my brothers. And ultimately, you know, the team and the coaching staff and administration did whatever they had to do to ultimately support me. And it was a wonderful thing to get to be myself and be a role model for others who, you know, could finally see themselves as a successful and openly LGBTQ athlete in Division I athletics.
Well, that's great. We'll sort of juxtapose that with you, Kyle, because I know from our conversations, it's a decision that you struggled with for some time. And so if you don't mind sharing your story of what some of the barriers, obstacles, challenges were along the way and how it feels to be on the other side.
Yeah, I grew up in a small town and growing up in kind of the 90s, there was no shortage of old school views, comments, opinions, and what used to be taken as dressing room talk or kind of grouped in as dressing room talk, some of that homophobic language brought a lot of conflict in terms of, you know, I agree with Andrew, you know, your teammates or your family, they're a second family, you spend so much time with them. So here are my teammates who I would go to battle with, I would die for, I'd do anything for them, but they don't know that I'm queer. And in all our off time, or even sometimes on ice or on floor, there's a lot of homophobic language happening. And so there's a lot of internal conflict in terms of the opinion I had, and you know, part of trying to stay closeted or stay hidden, blend in. You know, I've written about it before and openly admitted that I myself used homophobic language, even knowing that I was queer, just so I would fit in, just so that I didn't stick out like a sore thumb. You know, what was a deep secret and burden that I felt like I was carrying. I thought everybody knew, but probably everyone's just too busy with their own thing, or we're all focused on the game. So it was a tough environment coming through. And at the same time, I think it taught me a lot about tenacity and being able, especially my older years, my adult years, I think it taught me about being able to forgive and forget and see that people can grow, people can change. And I've been very fortunate to still be friends with a lot of those guys that I played hockey and lacrosse with. And the same way that I've evolved and society has been evolving, so have they. And so that gives me a lot of hope, not just for the youth, whether in the LGBTQ community or not, whether in sports or not, but just for society in general, that things can change and we're going in a better direction. That's for sure.
Great. We'll transition to you, Michelle. Would love to hear, you know, how much of what Andrew and Kyle shared resonates with you. I guess the timing of your decision to come out sounds more like Andrew's story, but how much of what they shared sounds familiar to you from the women's game, and what differences did you experience?
What resonated with me with Andrew's story was that I didn't want to hide anymore. I felt like I was lying, and I was young. So I was like 14, 15, 16 years old, where I'm like figuring this out. And that's like such an important part of years of your lives, where you're like, what do I like? What do I, you know, what are the hobbies, even like the smallest things? Like, but then I'm, you know, this big part of me was like, oh, I actually am having these feelings for someone that is the same sex as me. But I think I gave my own self more anxiety than I should have, because it was pretty, like, my high school was pretty open, and that's not common. There was multiple people that were actually feeling the same ways, but I put my own self in this anxiety ridden life because I was so worried about my family and my friends, but I was lying to them, and I was just like, I can't do this anymore. These are the people that I'm closest with. I'm one of five kids, you know, and we're all best friends. And it was just felt so awful. And I just felt like my mom was like, what's going on? And my parents were just like, what's going on? So I finally just like let it out. But it was individually, and like, it was like all different times. And thankfully my siblings were super accepting. I told my mom last, I think she still is upset about that. But she, you know, she had just a tough time in the beginning because she was worried about if my whole life would be hard, because women weren't able to get married, or men weren't able to get married to each other at the time. And she was worried I was going to get bullied, but thankfully, like, none of those things happened. And obviously laws have been changed. And then fast forward to the lacrosse piece, I went to school, you know, right after, you know, I was super open in high school, and I was like, I don't want to even for a second think that I didn't for a second want my teammates to think that I was who I wasn't. So I told them as exactly, you know, who I was as soon as I got there. No one even blinked an eye. You know, and to Kyle's point, there was, thinking back, I think there was like comments, but it wasn't, I didn't like get upset about them. And now I wonder if I would, because I was just, I knew they loved me. I knew they accepted me, but it's not, it probably, you know, in that moment, it wasn't okay to say, and I should have said something about it. So, but everyone was super accepting. Everyone was super loving. And, I'm really grateful for that because it allowed me to play the best that I could have played, to Andrew's point as well. Like I played because I felt on top of the world because I had so many people behind me. So I'm really grateful for that.
Great. I'd like to transition to what is maybe a little bit more of a serious topic and something that I've spent a lot of time reading about. It applies not just to this discussion, but anytime someone feels like they need to hide who they are. There's a lot of research done on the cost of covering, and there's costs to personal relationships. There's costs at work. There's costs to your mental health. There's costs to your physical health. So what are some of the things that, you know, people who want to be allies can do to create an appropriate environment for people to bring their authentic self to their life? From your guys' perspective, having lived sort of on both sides of it, meaning you've lived through a life where you felt like you needed to cover or hide who you were, and then being on the other side and feeling the difference in your ability to perform, to your point, Michelle. So I guess we could start with you, Kyle. What are some of the things that allies, whether it's teammates, friends, family, can do to help to create a positive, accepting environment?
I think this is such a great question. It's always nice to be with other people from the community because it yields so many different responses, so many different points of view. I'm a big fan and proponent of the, you know, ask questions, be open, be honest, be caring. The more that people take an opportunity to ask questions and learn and be educated, be open to the idea that we all have these unique lenses based on our upbringing and who we are. The opportunity is out there for anybody and everybody to see this world in such a more equitable environment and to really begin to fulfill that role of ally and supporter if we're taking the opportunity to ask those questions. So, you know, I think it's just a matter of have conversations, don't be afraid. You know, I was fortunate enough the other day that somebody, you know, schooled me on some information, and instead of sitting there and trying to have a rebuttal or this or that, it's that, you know, sit with open ears and see what they have to say. And I think, you know, how unique that this is coming from an official, because often players and officials will have such a unique standpoint and the conversations and the encounters that often go best are when one or both of the parties are really being active participants in that conversation. And they're being attentive, they're listening, and not just trying to force a point, but actually understand somebody else's point of view. That's when often those situations are getting solved. So just to kind of pair up sports to the question of how do we all become better supporters or stronger supporters.
That's great. Andrew, anything to add to that?
I think back from when I was closeted, which was a lot of the years of my young life, including into college, and the things that made me feel like I wasn't going to be accepted, or that I was only accepted because my friends and teammates and family thought I was someone that I wasn't. And I think about, you know, if someone is in that situation and they're in the closet, and what would they want those around them to be like? And, you know, the kinds of things that really messed with my head was, you know, first and foremost, the casual homophobia. you know, just using words that made me feel like I wouldn't be accepted when that wasn't truly how people felt. It was just using words without really putting a lot of thought behind it. So I think the flip side of that would be, you know, being thoughtful about your words. And I know that people don't want to have to always be so aware of every word that comes out of their mouth. But on the other hand, you know, hearing words like that's so gay or fag or homo, I mean, it really makes someone who's in the closet feel awful. And yet the person who's saying it usually doesn't have strong anti-LGBTQ views. They're just carrying on words that they've heard. And so I think to be a good ally, first and foremost, just be thoughtful about your words. And if you do say the wrong thing, try to, you know, think about it and try to understand what you can do. Also, you know, from when I was in the closet, people often ask, oh, do you wish that people maybe who suspected you were gay had kind of reached out and let you know that it'd be okay if you were gay? And actually, no, surprisingly, it would have made me feel really scared and really upset if they had come to me and suspected, you know, I was doing my best to try to hold up some front. And so I think from that same standpoint, if someone is, you know, it wants to be an ally and suspects maybe their friend is a member of the LGBTQ community, but hiding it, the best thing might not be to call them out on it. It might be to just let them know in the context of the real world that they support LGBTQ people, you know, and you can proactively say, I think that's really cool that two women can get married if they love each other, or, you know, I think it's really cool that this or that, rather than kind of making it feel like almost a witch hunt that you're kind of going to out someone before they're ready.
Yeah, I love that. And so helpful to get actual practical advice, because I think oftentimes people are uncomfortable because they don't know what to do. And so that's super helpful. Michelle, anything to add to that wasn't covered?
Yeah, actually, Andrew said a lot of stuff I was going to say, but I can speak to as with my coaching hat on, right? Because I always, you know, I get asked, like, how do you make sure you have an inclusive environment on your team, and what can you do? And a lot of what Andrew said as well is like the verbiage, the language. You know, if you're ever talking to a player, don't categorize them as having a boyfriend always, right? How is your partner? Do your partner, you know, like it's an easy word. And then also just showing your support for LGBTQ plus community, like as you guys have the logo, right? Like what, and all that you are doing, share those that information, share a podcast, share a book or a movie. And it's, you know, to the whole team. So, hey, I want you to know that I support this community. And I want you to know that this team should also, because this is, we want to make sure that everyone feels comfortable and that we support anyone in this sport that may identify as that. So that's some things that I've said that to help other, you know, lacrosse teams or any type of sport coach, that how do they make that environment more inclusive? And to, again, Andrew's point, like my college coaches never even like, they weren't like trying to out me if I was dating something, you know what I mean? Like, they were just like, you are who you are. And that's how it is. I just felt like a normal person at all times. So as normal as you can make it, but also feeling that those people feel supported, is super huge, because some people don't have it as easy. And it's super hard for certain people because everyone has different personalities. So just making sure that person just feels supported in any way possible is the biggest thing you can do.
Yeah. Those are all super helpful tips. I'll volunteer one more, although I've been accused of being like language police, not just being aware of what you say, but if you hear other people say it, to gently point it out. And I try to do it with like a disarming, like, benefit of the doubt. I know you're not, I just sort of dispel or diffuse anything by just saying, I know you don't mean what you're saying, but just so you know, anyone who hears that would think that you are, and you don't want people to think that. And that's super hard to do, I have to say, but it's something that, to your point, Michelle, that you made earlier, a lot of us can think back in our lives and think of times where we should have spoken up and didn't. And once you become aware of it, it's hard to unsee or unhear those things. And being complicit in that is just not acceptable anymore.
Jessica, just to piggyback on your comment, I work in a high school, and one of the things that we try and do, not just empower staff, but empower students, is to confront any kind of oppressive language, but do it in a less dramatic or less intense manner. Students who, might say, "Oh, science is so gay." It's like, is science getting married to science? Like, I don't understand. Like, are there other words we can use? And so just the idea of being able to call people out on it, like you said, it doesn't have to be such a huge conflict or dramatic issue. And at the same time, it also lets people save face in terms of if they're just using it casually, like you alluded to, I know Andrew said earlier, then it's kind of that, hey, nudge, we don't need to talk like that anymore. We are living in 2021, so let's change it up a bit.
Well, it's a good segue, Kyle, and I'll actually come back to you to talk about youth. And Michelle, I know you coach as well, and Andrew, you teach college students. Something that I've heard people say is like, is this really an issue anymore? Like, in 2021, are kids really facing this kind of bullying? Is there really sort of a lack of acceptance and inclusion happening at the youth level? I'm curious if you guys can share, whether you've been contacted by kids who are struggling with this, who are experiencing some of what you all have described you experienced as kids. Basically, is history repeating itself, or is this a generational issue and is it continuing? Maybe I'll start with you, Michelle.
I do get a lot of young lacrosse players, mostly young girls or young women that do reach out. Ever since I've been talking more openly about who I am, and the responses have been amazing. A lot of them are positive and, hey, you helped me come out or this and that. The ones that really upset me are the ones that their parents are very unaccepting. Like, they feel that they can't even, like, they'll get kicked out of the house, or they have got kicked out, or their parents think it's a phase. And then they're worried that their friends won't accept them because they feel like the people that should love them most won't accept them. And that breaks my heart. And I don't know how Andrew and Kyle, your family took it, but I was so lucky to have accepting family that I can't imagine not. So these young kids are, it's just like, I try to give them my best advice, and I tell them that there's nothing wrong with you. This is just you loving someone for, same sex. It doesn't matter. Like, don't think that this is something that is wrong with you. This is on them. And maybe sometimes your parents will come around. But it's hard for me because I try to give my best advice, and I think I do give good advice, but those ones hurt my heart, because it's like, these are people that should be loving them unconditionally, and they feel that they won't. So that's what's tough for me. I don't necessarily think that the kids are having a tough time at school. At least the kids that have DM'd me, they worry about it, but then once they talk to their friends about it, their friends are like, we love you. Like, and we want you to be happy. So I would say it's the coming out to the parents is the biggest issue I usually get.
Kyle, have you, I know it's recent, so it's, I guess, just in the last 6 months, have you been contacted by people. I know you bravely shared your story publicly without sports, and that was a really big moment for you, and maybe share why you took that approach and what the feedback has been and people that you've been able to help and support.
I knew since I was 13, but stayed in the closet for a variety of reasons. And, you know, part of it was survival. Part of it was the fear of acceptance. So I felt like I had a lot of time that I missed out on. So when I came out 6 months ago, I was like, gung-ho, how much can I do? How great can I impact this community? I've done, you know, all of this work in my professional career as an ally. And now how can I transfer to being a strong advocate as a member of the LGBTQ community? And Andrew talked about it earlier. There were really no gay athletes for me to look up to. I was raised on country and classic rock. So the only gay person that I knew was Elton John. And I love his music, but I didn't have any desire to dress in that manner in terms of a role model. So I essentially wanted to try and be that role model. I knew originally, obviously, I was doing it for me. I needed to be my authentic self. I needed to come out. It was part of, it was a big part of my own recovery. But also, I wanted to try and be on that forefront of things and maybe be part of some preventative stuff in terms of maybe that next youth that's coming up through the sports world has someone to look up to or has someone they can say, hey, I can compete. I can be who I am. I can grow my hair long, cut my hair short, paint my nails, dress feminine, dress masculine. You can be whoever you want, do whatever you want. Just work hard on the field. Just be the best athlete you can be. Nothing else is going to matter. If you score the game-winning goal for your team, nothing else matters. Right. It's I think that's the sports culture that I'm hoping that we're all going to get to be part of and see. In terms of is history repeating itself? Is this still I think it's still prevalent with youth. I would hope that it's less of a issue than it used to be. I don't know, maybe it's just being an old guy now, but I feel like technology is a bigger issue than accepting peers. I feel confident that the world has evolved, and even some of the people that I feared when I was growing up, I not so much feared, but I feared their opinion, or I feared that I would be rejected. You know, they've evolved. They've come around, they've taken on these new opinions, and in that person that Michelle is kind of alluding to, that youth who doesn't feel like they're going to be accepted by their friends and their family, I was that person, and I was just, I'm blown away, surprised with how little people cared about that. When I came out, they were just happy that I was happy. So I'm always a big fan of give people the opportunity to prove you right or prove you wrong, but let them surprise you and shock you with how much they love and care.
That's beautiful. Andrew, I'll ask you, and I know actually firsthand, I'm sure there's many other examples of people you've helped and supported, but we asked you to spend some time with Kyle when he was on his journey, and thank you for that. So would love to, applause for you. Thank you. Being from the lacrosse community and really being able to help others, I'm sure you have other examples. What has that experience been like? What have been your observation about the youth culture and people sort of coming up behind you?
I mean, Michelle mentioned marriage equality, which it's just so funny to think, you know, when we were younger and there were no LGBTQ people on film and television. And when they were there, it was, they were evil or they were going to die, or, you know, there was no representation of there being LGBTQ people who could live happy, healthy lives. And so much has changed, including some of us being able to be role models for young people. And so that's great. But I think an important thing to remember is that LGBTQ people don't usually grow up with LGBTQ parents. And so they, even if they can look to television or look to an athlete who came out, they don't necessarily have a lot of local support, and they usually feel pretty alone. And it's the fear that, you know, Kyle was mentioning the fear. The fear doesn't always match the reality. In fact, it luckily most often doesn't, but that fear still is intense. And we grew up with our own internalized homophobia, and you know, sometimes we're afraid of being out. But, you know, being able to hear messages from lots of young people over the years since I've come out. And one of the interesting things is, you know, people are coming out younger and younger. For example, there was this 12-year-old kid who reached out to me. Actually, his dad reached out to me because he was that young that he came out and he was struggling. And so I've seen these younger and younger kids coming out, and they face different challenges than I faced. When I came out, I was an adult. I was a college student. I was an All-American Division I athlete. These kids, 12, 11, 13 years old, that's a lot of life to live being the only openly LGBTQ person in their family, in their school, in their community, depending on what part of the country or part of the world they're in. That's really scary. And that's a lot of years to have to hold on to that. Where maybe someone like me, I had a lot of those years in the closet where I was beating up on myself, but I didn't have to be so exposed for that long. And so it's so awesome that these young people live in a different world and they see, oh, I can grow up and marry the person I love and have a family and be happy and healthy. And I can be a college athlete or a pro athlete. I can be like Michelle on Team USA. But they still have to face every single day going to school and going to whatever they do, being so exposed. And I think that's scary.
Yeah, well, everyone who's listening and beyond is lucky to have at least the three of you as role models, to be so open and sharing in all of your vulnerabilities and providing such amazing advice. So I guess we'll start to transition to wrapping up. You know, I think a lot of the people who will be listening are lacrosse fans and fans of the NLL, and would love to hear, maybe we'll start with you, Kyle. What's your view of the lacrosse community and how they've embraced you, and what can we all do better as we go forward?
First off, in terms of role models, I'd like to make it known that you can play goalie and be smarty pants. I think Andrew's proven that, just so well spoken in these answers. But, you know, all of us goalies, we're not dumb or crazy. We've got something to offer. In terms of coming out, and the response from the lacrosse community, I mean, the amount of support that I got from all my referee family, people that I, you know, a guy that I played 1 year of junior with, cause he was aging out and I was in my rookie year, reached out to me 20 years later and said, hey, just wanted to say that, good for you, fully support you. That's awesome. And hope that I was never one of those guys that was using that negative language. And you know, that's some pretty amazing stuff. The NLL has been a huge support, obviously, in my journey. Jessica, yourself, Brian Lemon, you already talked about Andrew kind of being a role model in terms of having a conversation with me ahead of time. I thought it was going to be a taxing process at first, and then it became this glorious, enjoyable process. And from players to coaches to just people involved in Ontario lacrosse, just reaching out with their love and support, it's been overwhelming in the most amazing way possible. And I think Andrew said it perfectly in terms of, we create these fears in our mind of people are going to have all this homophobia and this, it's going to be a terrible situation. It was so far from that in my experience. And I am really grateful to have been supported by everybody. Yes, thank you so much for doing all of this, and you know, hopefully that a conversation like this supports other people, whether they're in the community, whether they're not in the community, but just that idea of everyone matters and everyone has a place.
Thank you. And you've been so inspirational for us, and it's been a pleasure to support you and learn from you along the way. Andrew, I'll go to you next, and we'll let Michelle have the final word. You know, you're obviously now sort of in a very different world than you were in the lacrosse space, but thinking back to your lacrosse days and how the community showed up for you, what are your reflections on that? And what do you have to say to sort of the coaches and teammates along the way, and fans who are listening and want to do better?
Well, first off, I'm just so grateful for the lacrosse community, for everyone I came into contact with, everyone I played alongside and you know, worked alongside, that never made who I was after I came out, never made it an issue. And I think that there's something beautiful about that. When I came out in college, it was scary because it was so like unprecedented. And my teammates, they did everything they could to make clear, we've got your back. If someone says something on the field, we're gonna beat them up. And it's like, no, don't do that, because we don't want to get a penalty, you know. But it was great. And even I remember my college coach, he came to me after a road trip and he said, that movie we watched, I noticed that there was some homophobic language. Do you think that maybe we should be pre-screening the movies to make sure everything's okay before? I'm like, we don't have to do that, but that's very thoughtful of you and very cool that you know, want to be proactive and that. And I remember actually in college, one of my teammates who was a captain, we had this regular practice of letting people know when there were people on television that they'd want to watch. You know, you can change your station to that. And my captain reached out to me that Andy Roddick, who was one of my crushes at the time, yeah, I had a whole wall of Tom Brady and Andy Roddick when I was in college, to say that Andy Roddick is playing, you know, in the US Open, you gotta go check it out. And it just shows how cool people could be. Actually, remember after I just a few days after I graduated college, I went to I think it was in Baltimore or somewhere for the U.S. national team tryouts. So this was 2005. So I guess it was in preparation for the 2006 World Games. And so, you know, a lot of people go there for this camp, and I definitely had no chance of getting selected. But it was pretty awesome to go. And the first day I got there, I had you know, obviously was the only openly gay player there, and Casey Powell, who at the time was the best player in the world, in front of everyone just walked right up to me, gave me one of those bro hugs, and said, anyone says anything to you, like, you come to me and I'll take care of it. And I didn't have to, because everyone saw that moment. And, you know, then when I played in Major League Lacrosse, actually just a few years ago, the commissioner of the MLL from when I was drafted and played, he said, you know, we never wanted to make any big press releases about having, you know, drafted the first openly gay male pro team sport athlete, because we just thought it would be better to show that it didn't matter to us at all. And that's just such a beautiful thing that, you know, you see the NFL goes out of their way to publicize anytime anyone does something good for the community. And the lacrosse world was just wanting to do the opposite, to actually go out of their way to show it wasn't a big deal. And I just love that.
Yeah, it's amazing. Well, it's an honor to be working in the lacrosse world. Michelle, I guess any final thoughts, reflecting on your experience? You're actually actively playing with the US team. We're excited to be watching you this summer. So any final thoughts?
Thank you so much for that. No, I just, you know, I want Kyle and Andrew, I know you guys probably, I think this in ways, but you guys, we are pretty cool role models to some of these young kids and people of our ages. And I bet you've helped way more people than you've ever realized. I think that's the most rewarding thing, is just being yourself and being proud of it. I've seen that a lot. I never thought I would do this, have such a positive impact from just talking about who I am. And I want both of you to know that even tonight, learning from both of you, it's incredible to hear it. And it makes me so happy, because I do feel like there are more out women on the women's side. And I just know that if there's ever someone thinking to come out, that they're going to look at your stories and be really proud that you guys are on our side and in our sport. But yeah, I like I said, I've just had such an amazing experience. And it's really cool to see all the initiatives that everyone has been taking on. And we have a great new pro league coming out this July. Athletes Unlimited, we're going to be playing on TV, first time ever for women's lacrosse, and they've taken on some pretty cool initiatives as well, just about all diversity, all inclusion, and as we all say, the sport is for everyone. And I'm so grateful for all the friends and relationships I've built because of this sport and the places it has taken me, for me as Michelle Tumolo, and not anything else but that. So thank you so much for having me. And I'm so grateful that I got to learn from you, Kyle, and you, Andrew.
Well, we'll all give hearts and show off our, I know you guys have your shirts, and excited to express how we all support the three of you and the entire community. And thank you guys for being with us tonight and sharing your stories so authentically and so honestly, and appreciate everything you do to show up every day for your community. So thank you, everyone. And that's all.